Thank you for the invitation to this conference here. And yes, you might ask yourself, what is this now? Trees on dams and dikes. We are talking about avenues. But you may agree with me that a waterway is also a kind of road, and that these trees along the canal here serve the same issues than trees along roads. I was involved in this project, renovation of the Störkanal, 6 years ago, and I was called by the people by living there. And when I first saw the oaks along the Störkanal, I was deeply impressed by the beauty and grandeur of these sturdy trees. They have been standing on the dam along the canal for about 140 years. They always had good growing conditions, enough space for the roots, and enough water. No de-icing salt in winter, few cuts, no root digging. The tree could simply develop beautifully. And so they stood there, one as beautiful as the other. But now they should be felled with the renovation of the dams. It was immediately clear to me that BUND, the association I belong to, that is a German branch of Friends of the Earth, together with many other allies, would have to find solutions that would make it possible to preserve this old canal avenue. In this presentation, I show how joint commitment can lead to a good result. The development of human civilization is connected with the desire for more land, navigability, and flood protection. Rivers and streams were straightened and diked. A large number of once meandering rivers and streams now run through the landscape as strictly uniform structures. They were once wider and shallower and spread over an entire river plain. Floodplain forests grew on their banks. There was a great variety of animal species on land and in the rivers. Instead, we lost natural habitats and biodiversity of animals and plants. These waterways are now shortened, straightened, deepened. Transport is therefore faster without obstacles, and it is possible for large ships. This encouraged trade, cities, and industry developed along the rivers. It was promised that the straightening of the rivers would prevent flooding, but the floods have only shifted downstream. It is a fact that as long as the river do not get more space, flood cannot be avoided. Landscape architects, therefore, engineers, biologists, and even hydraulic engineers are questioning the demand currently manifested in standards in Germany, which states that woody plants, trees, shrubs, and hedges on dikes and dams are fundamentally unacceptable because they apparently impair stability and maintenance. Those responsible refer to this not only for new constructions, but also when it comes to tolerating and planting trees on dams and dikes during renovation measures. Engineering biology has very good answers to the question of how plants can be used as living building material to secure dams and dikes. For many decades, representatives of nature conservation and landscape management, associations, and local citizens have been calling for environmental compatible solutions to be implemented. The reconstruction of the Stör waterway in the Lewitz with an oak avenue shows that dam reconstruction with preservation of the tree population is possible and even sensible. The Stör waterway is a 44.7 kilometer long waterway in the west of Mecklenburg-Pomerania. You see the little star on the map. That is the region of the Lewitz, and the waterway includes the Störkanal, the River Stör, and the Lake Schwerin. The first section, which is about 11 kilometer long, is the Störkanal. The Oak Avenue is along the first section with a length of about 2.28 kilometers, which you see here on this map. The Levitz is an almost uninhabited lowland of about 13 by 16 kilometer in size between the Mecklenburg towns Schwerin, Parchim, and Neustadt-Lewe. The low population of the Levitz area for centuries meant that unique flora and fauna could unfold almost undisturbed. The Levitz is protected under EU directive as a special protected area. In particular, to preserve and develop the West Lowlands landscape and the fens, natural forest, rows of trees, hedges, and water bodies. Despite its low population density, the Levitz was also transformed into a cultural landscape. After deforestation, large meadows and arable land were created. The huge rectangular fish ponds, you can see here also, quite well known in our region, also as a tourist attraction. As early as the 16th century, the Stör waterway was used as a transport route for timber from the Levitz, so that the expansion of the waterway began at that time. The Stör Canal was built around 709. The part of the canal where the oaks stand today was built as a last section in 751 by the Duke of Mecklenburg. You can see this last section here pointed out with this arrow. The city of Schwerin was very interested in an extension of the Stör waterway, which was only partially navigable in the 18th century due to shallow water. Initiatives, however, always failed because of lack of money. In 1830, the canal was extended with dams so that the water level could be dammed higher than the surrounding area. The oaks were planted on top of the dam as an avenue around 1880. The reason for the planting have not been clarified. It can be assumed that the root should reinforce the dam, that the canopy should reduce herbaceous growth, and that the trees were planted for aesthetic reasons. Another important reason could have been the shading of the water and the towpath, because the barges were pulled along the canal by humans at this time. Other trees and shrubs were also planted along the dams. In 1839, for example, 4,200 willow cuttings were planted because of the great demand for fodder and firewood. And in 1915, there was a planting of birch trees at the distance of 2 meters from the northern edge of the plenum, demanded by the ministry. The iconic importance of the waterway declined in 1990. Today, it's mainly used by pleasure boats. When I was involved in this project, I had to learn first, what is a dam, what is a dike? It is not the same. A dam, as considered in this presentation, is a structure that supports a water level and, if necessary, provides additional protection against flooding. It is an artificial embankment made of natural or artificial material with a low hydraulic permeability. It serves to prevent or minimize water losses from the waterway. Sometimes sheet piles or other structures support the bank reinforcement. In comparison, a dike serves to protect the hinterland against flooding and is only under pressure in the event of flooding. A dam is therefore permanently exposed to water pressure, a dike only in the event of flooding. We don't talk about here about energy production dams or railway dams. The dam construction on the Stör Canal. The dams of the Stör waterway no longer met the static requirements in some sections, especially in flood situations. Therefore, Mecklenburg Waterway and shipping authorities planned the reconstruction of these dams from 2011. Part of the Stör waterway, the Stör Canal in the Levitz area, is characterized by this oak avenue standing on the dam. The original planning provided for a complete clearing of the trees and the subsequent overfilling and reinforcement of the old dam. This plan follows the standards and regulations which are used today in Germany. Even though these DIN norm, DIN standards are not binding, they are often handled like laws by the responsible authorities and implemented without compromise. They have some strong arguments, like the movement of the trees lead to loosening of the soil. Of course, if a tree falls, it gives a big hole in the dam or dike. The turf is suppressed. Woody plants favor the colonization of rooting animals. The dam observation can be considerably impaired, and mechanism of the dike and dam is made more difficult. On the other hand, scientists also describe an increase in the strength of rooted earth structures, in particular due to improvement, the shear strength and stabilizing effect of tensile and retaining roots, for example, that was shown in the Berliner Landwehrkanal in 2008 and along a Rhine dike in 2007 and 2018. Yet in practice, no consideration is usually given to whether the trees on the dikes or dams are protected from the wind or whether they are exposed to the storm, whether there is a strong current or a calm lake. Trees are unpredictable for hydraulic engineers. They can fall or can tear holes in the dike. It is often more important to take this into account than to include the reinforcing effect of tensile structures. Each standard can only provide orientation. It is important to determine whether the generalization of the standard is in line with a specific situation. The dam of the Stürkanal is used, so the water level, even without flooding, is higher than the area on land side. That's the reason given for the renovation of the Stürkanal was the existing profile and dam height were for the most part no longer sufficient, and there was a risk of dam bursting or flooding. The dams are constantly exposed to water pressure. In order to withstand the pressure safely or permanently, a minimum cross-section of the dam is required, which was not available in many areas. In the area of dam crest, there were sags. Therefore, the dam were to be raised by 20 to 50 centimeters, and the crown width was to be widened to 3 to 4 meters and compacted, and the trees were to be felled. So there was a big resistance to the planned construction measures by the local people, by environmentalists, and also by our association. The locals founded a new association, Lewitz-Netzwerk, and together with us, we did a lot of public relation at this time. Like this here, you can see protests in front of the Waterway and Shipping Authority in Magdeburg, which were responsible for this project. And all these protests had a first good result, and that was the preservation of the Oak Avenue was put into this plan approval decision. So the plan approval, the planning authority was forced to preserve the 213 oak trees that form the image of the Canal Avenue. From the point of view of the associations, however, it did it only half-heartedly with an attempt to preserve the trees by backfilling. Another 207 trees, 130 oak trees, and several shrubs and other trees were still to be felled. There was a danger we could see that the 230 oaks to be obtained according to the approval would also not survive the construction measure by backfilling up to 50 centimeter, including compaction in the root area. The contradiction was also that the necessary implement another norm, which is the norm for vegetation technology and landscaping protection of trees, plantations and vegetation areas during construction work. This was also pointed out, and this regulation states that no soil or other substances may be applied in the root area. Trenches, touts, excavation pits must not be constructed in the root area, and the root area must not be damaged by loads, for example, traffic storage, construction site, and equipment. So this was a few pages before it came to overfilling with 50 centimeter and compaction. And we saw there a contradiction. But the Magdeburg Waterway and Shipping Authority did not accept the criticism of the associations with regard to the contradiction in the plan approval. Only after Lauenburg Waterway and Shipping Authority, that is a local shipping authority, had taken over the project planning, there was a willingness to talk. Now all necessary protective measures for oaks were discussed. A tree expert was appointed to prepare and accompany the construction work, one of the main demands of the association in cooperation with the engineering of, offices for project planning. To get the results, we had to really do a hard work on public relations. We invited politics from the Bundestag and Landtag to a podium discussion. We did an open letter to our minister, responsible with other associations. And we also did some posters here, as you can see, and banners which were firstly painted at the Marienplatz in Schwerin with, of course, a lot of press and media, and then attached to the oak trees on the Störkanal. And we invited to discussion on site. And yes, one could say that our great commitment and the joint public relation work had resulted in a willingness to cooperate on the part of the Waterway Authority, in particular the Lauenburg branch. And the discussion promised a willingness to cooperate and openness for further action, which seemed first impossible. And here you see a lot was done in the press as well. And finally, the result that a tree expert was involved, which was not done before. In addition to the criticism, the association made it clear that they see the project as an opportunity to optimize the project together and with a will to reach a consensus among all of those involved, so that the reconstruction of the dam does not justice to all the different interest groups. The reconstruction of the Störkanal could thus have an effect beyond our federal state. And now, although the authority followed the requirements for dam reconstruction, all possibilities have now been examined within the decision to achieve the second goal, the preservation of the designated trees and the preservation of further trees that were to be felled according to the approval. The preservation of the avenue on the top of the dams was defined by mutual agreement. That meant at this stage also the planting in the gaps. The monitoring of all measures of the dam reconstruction by a tree expert was a beginning and was assured a great success of the association, as this was our main point of criticism. The original planning included only a rough estimate of the impact of the planned renovation work on the row of trees. It was claimed that the overfilling of the steeply slopes bank of the steeply sloping bank edge of approximately 50 centimeter could be compensated by the oak trees. The condition of the ballast filter and the construction were not explained in detail. Therefore, the first work the two experts did was a root excavation. And you see it here on the picture, how it was done with a quite small sucking equipment. A total of 19 search ditches were carried out on 5 oak trees. The 25 to 85 centimeter deep and approximately 30 centimeter wide search ditches had lengths of 2 to 5 meter and ran lengthwise and crosswise to the dam body in different levels. In the case of spring formation, a vehicle with 1 cubic meter of backfilling material was to be provided at the excavation site. Before a further trench was constructed, the previously constructed ditch had to be filled and compacted. Employees of the waterway authority accompanied the search excavation constantly and kept 2,500 sandbags on the barge moored at the area of the search excavation in case of an accident. The digging results. The documented intensive and uniform root penetrations of the dam body is judged by all project participants to stabilize the dam after presentation of the excavation results. In particular, along taking are also taking into account the sometimes very loose humus sands on the dams. The future models for dam safety needs to take into account the increased shear strength caused by root penetration. The positive aspects of trees are rated higher than any possible danger. The original design of the dams was not only unsuitable for reasons of tree preservation, but would also lead to major damage to the dam body in the medium to long term. The dying root system would leave behind water-carrying pipes, and the dam would collapse. Everyone involved in the project agreed that the dams could only be reconstructed if the trees were preserved. The practical execution of the dam reconstruction was as followed. On the bank side, the pile wall was to be reinforced by fleece layers. Missing piles were replaced. The space between the edge of the bank and the pile was filled by armor stones, and the dam crest was covered with humus sand, lean grassland, and gravel. Here you can see how the fleece was built in. Safety measures on the land side were the profiling of the ballast filter, which is considered necessary for the dam statics, and that leads to an overfilling height of up to 1.55 meter, which is obviously quite high. The unavoidable negative effect of overfilling should be limited by following measures. The dam could not be driven over with heavy equipment. In order to avoid water accumulation in the root horizon on the clay layer and the associated danger of rotting processes, breakthroughs into the underlying horizon of the dam was necessary. Therefore, 870 pipes were installed down to the depth of 1.8 meter in a maximum distance of 2 meter between the pipes and filled with gravel. And there was a protective mesh against burrowing animals attached. The work was completed at the end of May 2018. Planning and construction meant a compromise for all involved, yet the beautiful oaks can still be admired. And those who haven't been there during the construction work may not even notice that there is anything different. The effect of the protective measure is further to be observed by a tree expert for over a period of 10 years. And the one responsible from the watership and from the water authorities described the exceptional good cooperation with the association. It was actually a process where we all learned a lot, and they agreed as well that they have it was an eye-opener to them as well. The approach presented here cannot be regarded as a general solution to similar conflicts between dam or dike restoration and tree conservation. In any case, it is worthwhile to examine the initial situation individually and without prejudice, and to seek joint solutions for all those involved. That is the result. Thank you very much.